Good afternoon, everybody. I guess we'll go ahead and get started. And welcome to our inaugural Tuesday lunch series. It's wonderful to see so many familiar faces, and hope you're having a good start to the new year. So for those of you who may not know me, my name is Joe Tagg. I teach in the history department, and I have the honor this semester of serving as our Tuesday lunch moderator. And to that end, it is with great pleasure that I introduce Charlie St. George, Assistant Professor of Spanish in the Modern Languages Department, who will be speaking to us about Mexicanidad as race, gender, and neoliberal ideology in Patricia Regan's La Misma Luna, Under the Same Moon. So, Charlie, welcome.
Thank you, Jane. Well, Under the Same Moon is a film that kind of my desire to write about it came from my teaching, where this is a very popular film that a few students decided in my seminars to base their final projects on. And there are a lot of really good, you know, redeeming qualities to the film, but there are some problems as well, and those just kept nagging at me in the back of my mind the more that I saw the movie come up in student papers, and now it's actually part of a textbook that we use for conversation and cinema in Spanish. So I decided to write a paper about some of the problems that I see in the film, and if you, after listening to my captivating 20-minute presentation, if that's not enough for you, and you want to see the full version, it will be coming out in the March issue of The Latin Americanist, March 2018. So this is a film that debuted simultaneously in Mexico and the U.S. in 2008. It's in its first weekend alone, racked up $1.7 million in Mexico and $2.6 million in the U.S., which set a new record for Spanish language film in terms of opening weekend at the box office in the U.S. And the little bit of academic criticism that has been published about this film is mainly positive, and for good reason. I mean, critics like Carolyn C. Conley and Laura Senyo Blair have noted that the film kind of departs from traditional Mexican narratives on immigration, in that instead of focusing on a male as the immigrant and failure as the outcome, or shame, or some such negative consequence, this film focuses on a single mother as an immigrant, and her relationship with her 9-year-old son that she's left behind in Mexico for her mother, his grandmother, to raise. There's also praise for the film because, for American audiences, it does a pretty good job of humanizing undocumented immigrants. And I do think that's very important. It is a very melodramatic film. It really, you know, it takes that mother-son relationship and the separation and the imperative to reunite them, you know, the ethical narrative imperative to reunite them at the end. It generates a lot of emotions. Kind of just tugs at your heartstrings in all the right ways. Especially because, you know, what starts off in the movie is this weekly telephone call that Rosario, the mother, makes to her son Carlos in Mexico from Los Angeles, from a payphone. This is how they check in every week, and they haven't seen each other for a few years. What complicates this tradition is that his grandmother suddenly dies unexpectedly. And so he has no immediate family around him, and he decides, as a very independent and strong-minded 9-year-old that he's just going to go to LA from northern Mexico on his own and find his mother. So, you know, you see this 9-year-old who's just set loose across the wilds of the northern frontier and then eventually makes it into the US, and there's threat after threat against him that he has to somehow overcome. And, you know, naturally as human beings, we're looking at this and, oh my God, I hope this 9-year-old is gonna make it out of this okay. But my argument is that it's exactly that dynamic that kind of conceals the highly ideological agenda at work in this movie. And so I don't want to detract from the film's importance. I don't want to take away from its effectiveness in terms of humanizing undocumented immigrants for an American audience. I myself had tears in my eyes at the very end. That's not hard, though. but where I'm more concerned is with a Mexican audience and the cultural norms and messages that are reinscribed from Mexico's power structures, and how this is a rather self-serving message for those who are the political and economic elite of Mexico, who are largely responsible for this ongoing immigration crisis and the separation of families. So, of course, plenty of academics have written on the ideological value of the child protagonist. And I've kind of explained already, just in terms of the plot, how this film is so effective. Masud Zabarzadeh says that the mother, in terms of mother-child relationships, that the emotional is privileged while the analytical and the interrogatory are suppressed, just as I have described. And of course, you have Althusser, who refers to the family as one of several ideological state apparatuses. And Kaya Silverman has said that it is through ideological belief that a society's reality is constituted and sustained, that a subject lays claim to a normative identity. And this is, of course, for a Mexican viewing audience, this normative identity is Mexicanidad. And the way that that is articulated through as reality through the lens of family relationships completely obfuscates a larger systematic critique of the systems of power that are at work within Mexico to contribute to this phenomenon of immigration. The title of the talk talks about race, gender, and neoliberal ideology. And I wanted to start with race. Silverman, in the same essay, says that the world's working class people inhabit different ideological worlds and presumably recognize themselves within competing images. And Under the Same Moon is full of these competing images. There's kind of a dichotomy at work between Anglo-Americans and Mexicans, both transnational living in the US and back home in Mexico. There's a long line. One New York Times critic referred to it as a parade of nasty gringos that kind of dot the trajectory of the film's plot. And so you get like this first young man here underneath the American flag. He is a drug addict he's the first person to come across Carlitos once he's made it across the border. And he is promising to help the child while actually looking for a way to sell him to the highest bidder for drug money. So he's, ostensibly materialistic, just concerned. The fact that this is a child, the grammar of family and the adult ethical imperative to take care of defenseless children is kind of what makes him inhumane and therefore not Mexican. There's also plenty of cruelty, and this is not to say that we don't have plenty of materialistic or cruel or racist things at work in terms of the US and our political and cultural narrative. But in the film, Anglo-Americanness is pretty much limited to these qualities. There's a flashback to Rosario, the mother's initial crossing, And this is the border patrol agent with a flashlight, and he says, "Welcome to America, Juanito." And, you know, it's just perceived as just not really seeing Mexican people, as humans, but rather just a problem to be dealt with and to be mocked. So, like I said, while there, you know, we're not lacking in examples of this type of a dynamic, what this dichotomy ends up doing is attributing qualities such as racism and greed uniformly to the Anglo-American other, as if those same qualities did not exist within Mexico's own socioeconomic and political hierarchy. And there's I'm gonna show four or five clips from the film, and I hope you can see the subtitles okay. But this is one example as racism as geographic determinism. And this is where Rosario, the mother, is speaking with other immigrants from Mexico in Los Angeles.
¿Y eso?
Ah, pues es una guía del examen de ciudadanía. Es que si funciona el abogado lo voy a tener que tomar. Aunque no sé nada de la historia de Estados Unidos, ¿eh?
Ah, pues está bien fácil. Primero se jodieron a los pobres indios. Luego se jodieron los esclavos y los están jodiendo los mexicanos.
Ah, huevo.
So, what this does is it pretends, first of all, that there is no racism at work in Mexico that is screwing over the poor Indians, even as we speak, right? I think the Zapatistas in Chiapas and other indigenous movements within Mexico would take issue with the idea that it's only the Americans that have done that, and that somehow it's a part of history and not an ongoing socio-political reality for millions of indigenous people in Mexico who somehow are now subsumed historically into just the generic group Mexico or Mexicans. And in doing so, the white privilege that exists in rather ostensible fashion in Mexico is, and the, you know, the very visible marginalization of indigenous communities is just completely invisibilized through this historical revisionism. Another example of geographic determinism is the evolution of the character Enrique, who is one of many fellow immigrants that Carlitos happens upon, but he is the exception among the Mexican characters in that he starts off being very cold and indifferent and self-serving, and he doesn't really want to be bothered with this child who's, you know, running off on his own. He's invested in what is kind of represented as the American dream, right? Economic self-interest, nothing else matters, including even family values, such as taking care of a child. So he's bitter, he's closed off, he's only interested in money. Through a few twists and turns of the plot, he is stuck with Carlitos. And they are both on the road looking for work and then eventually looking to get to Los Angeles to find Carlitos's mother. So by the time they get to Los Angeles, and you can hopefully see this in just his facial expression, like this evolution that happens in his character that translates into character redemption. Because as much as he resists it, all his time of interaction with Carlitos kind of generates this fatherly concern for him. And at a point in Los Angeles when Carlitos is discovered by the police and is being put into a patrol car, Enrique distracts them and they go running after him so that Carlitos can escape to continue looking for his mother. And so you see him here handing himself in, and then for the first time you see this smile. This is as he's being lowered into the police car to be deported himself. But you see him happy for the first time. So his humanization is parallel to his re-Mexicanization and literally his repatriation, right? He will be sent back to Mexico, which is seen as kind of the emanating source of family values and what's really important in life versus the cold, money-driven American agenda. In terms of gender, there's a lot at work. and I'm just going to give you a couple of examples here. But this is Carlitos in the house of a woman who actually bought him from the aforementioned drug addict who was looking to sell the child on the street for drug money. She just reached into her purse and threw whatever money she had at him in a gesture that clearly says, money doesn't matter, families matter, right? And so here he is, his first night at her house.
Hola.
Buenas tardes.
Buenas tardes.
Permiso, doñita. Buenas tardes, señora Reina.
Hola. ¿Quiénes son? Ilegales. Como tú.
Aguas, que ya llegó su hombre.
Ay, qué huele, mi reinita. Albóndiga.
Ay.
¿Y tú? ¿Quién eres?
Carlos Reyes, a sus órdenes.
Leonardo Sánchez Nava, para servirle, paisanito.
So in that clip, the adult man refers to him as paisanito, like my little countryman. And this is a status that is conferred upon him upon proper performance of the codes of Mexican masculinity with the handshake and also the colonial servitude of, you know, at your orders, here to serve you. These are the codes of masculinity. And theorists, including Slavoj Žižek, have talked about the importance of these gestures, such as the handshake between men, that they can even be performed skeptically while still maintaining, reinscribing the same level of cultural importance and reinscribing Mexican masculinity as such, as this relationship between men. So Carlitos, as someone who's only 9 years old, but is doing a really good job at performing all of these codes of masculinity, kind of functions as a way to naturalize the ideology of Mexicanidad. You know, if a 9-year-old child is doing it, children, they just do whatever comes out of their mouth. They're the closest to humanity in its natural state before they've been formed by society into adults. And so that's kind of another dynamic at work there, where the ideological nature of any national identity is kind of sold off as natural, as biological to any child who comes directly from the heartland. And we also see, I mentioned already the main crux of the character redemption for Enrique, but this is a scene on the bus from Tucson to Los Angeles where there was still something else before Enrique can be fully redeemed as a character. There's still one lingering question for a Mexican audience in terms of what about his family, right? He's a single man who is on his own, working in Mexico. He's made no mention of family. He appears not to be sensitive to the issues of family or family values or the plight of children. And so even his sexual orientation is somewhat of a mystery, right? Until this scene, which happens at a strategic point in terms of his evolution and redemption as a character. It's a photo of his mom. So it happens on a dark bus, and probably you didn't get to see most of the images, but we now have confirmation that Enrique is a red-blooded, properly female-desiring, hetero-masculine Mexican. And I've got one more of such a scene that is another humorous example, if I can get the cursor to stop being so squirrely. Let's go, cursor. Come on, there we go.
¿Qué huele?
Buenas.
Hola.
Hola.
¿Y el niño dónde está?
Ah, no venía contigo.
No, yo no lo conozco. Yo no.
Carlos Reyes.
Hernán.
Carlos,
corre.
Carlos. ¿Qué pasa, Carlos?
Enrique.
So, yes, the shining bright example of proper codes of Mexicanidad shows up the adult who should know better and somehow has lost sight of that in the American dream, and then is embarrassed, like, oh yeah, my name is Enrique. So the other part of this is neoliberal ideology in terms of Mexicanidad. And we're kind of going back in time here, but this is back at Doña Reina's house, the kind of the safe house where Carlitos had his first handshake. And everyone's gathered together. They're all kind of in limbo in a new place in a very precarious situation, but they find comfort over the common terrain that they have in soccer.
Esto está bien sabroso. Y estaría mejor con una chelita.
No me hagan enojar a la reinita. Ya saben las reglas. Nada de alcohol. Y se aguantan. Como los machos.
A menos que mis chivas jueguen en contra del América.
So there's a few things going on there in terms of consumer behavior and Mexicanidad. One is, of course, the aforementioned allegiance to one football club or the other within Mexico. That kind of binds your cultural passport if you can show that you're for Chivas, for example, and against America. That also proves to be an amenable resolution to quote, oh, who was it? I think it was Gledhill, in terms of the way that these larger socioeconomic and cultural conflicts play themselves out in venues such as soccer fields, so that the actual tensions that are within a nation can be easily resolved in an entertaining fashion in the realm of sports, in this case, soccer. You know, we're not talking then about the tension between rich and poor, or whites or indigenous. We are talking about Chivas versus America. Of course, there's some gendering going on there as well in terms of the dining room and the kitchen are the realm of the female, and she's the one, you gotta put up with her rules, like como los machos, right? Like macho men. And only she can decide when it's okay to make an exception for the rule. And then this is a scene in Los Angeles where Carlitos is looking for his mother, and you notice in the scene that he just happened to first look at the bag of Redonditos, or like Chicha. I was really going for the Chivas, Chelas, and Chicharrones. Chivas being the team, Chelas being beers, and then Chicharrones here, where through consuming Mexican food, the stranger on the street corner here, his identity is confirmed as Mexican, and therefore I can just proceed in Spanish to ask him a question. And this transnational consuming of Mexican cultural products is something that actually encapsulates the film and its viewing as well. It sends the idea that especially to, I mean, what was it, 2.6 million in the U.S. just in the first weekend. There's obviously a large population here that is Mexican in origin and is desperate to see themselves represented somehow in cinema, because these immigration movies are very few and far between. And it's by being able to buy a ticket, usually the class of people in Mexico who can go to the highly Americanized and standardized network of movie theaters that are almost parallel with American ticket prices just to go see a movie. This is a marker of being middle class in Mexico or higher, right? Whereas if you're from the working class and the disenfranchised, you cannot typically afford to blow that much money on just one ticket at Cinépolis, right? But if you've been, because of that, income inequality that is so rampant in Mexico, those people who then make it into the U.S. and are able to purchase a ticket, even if it's just as a treat to see themselves represented in some form or another, that is then honorary Mexicanness, right? Where they were excluded from the Mexican movie viewing population because of their economic status, the status that they have now gained through finding employment in the United States allows them to reconnect with that Mexican identity in terms of consumer practices. And that's why this film I'm so concerned about. I mean, on the one hand, yes, it's really great, you know, for representation to be had for these marginalized groups. But on the other hand, it's coming from a Mexican power source that has a vested interest in literally selling them Mexicanidad along these really cute and cuddly terms and familiar terms and emotionally affirming terms, so that there is absolutely no critique of or visibility of the larger power structures that are at work in Mexico. And so the film ends. And there's another scene where Carlitos, you know, he's with this group of immigrant men and they're all working at picking tomatoes. He, as a 9-year-old, is not expected to work, but he gets in there anyway. And he's working right alongside them, and it's adorable. But it's also part of this pick yourself up by your bootstraps, like, you know, Carlitos made it through this really precarious situation because of his unyielding Mexicanidad and because of his can-do attitude and his strong work ethic even as a 9-year-old, right? And that's kind of the message sent, that, you know, if you don't make it, if you don't make your really impossible situation work, millions of disenfranchised people in Mexico, right, then it's because you have not properly embodied Mexicanidad, whether through work ethic or proper gender roles, as we saw with Reina, like cooking and doing laundry for all of those men. And I just wanted to end then with the Tigres del Norte. That was the group. They're a really popular group. They're the group that were in the bus that you saw. And they end up singing a song during the ending credits. And I think this is a pretty good way of wrapping up my thesis here in terms of the candy-coated way in which stories of migration in bourgeois narrative are coded along family relationships instead of larger power structures. And I'm going to do my best Tigres del Norte impression for you so that you know how the melody goes. So it's really norteño, like, boom, 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 boom. A mí no me asusta el peligro, la vida sin riesgo no es nada. Si es por los seres queridos, se debe encontrar la salida. Yo no me voy a rendir hasta tenerte junto a mí. Si por amor soy capaz de parar con el pecho una bala. Si por amor yo me arriesgo a cruzar esta vez a la mala. Y por amor es que voy a cruzar la frontera sin miedo. And it's like this. I really wanted to be the first academic to impersonate the Tigres del Norte at Denison. And if I have achieved nothing else, I hope that is it. Thank you so much for your time and your attention.